John Chipolino. He recorded one of his songs. John also played with Bob Dylan. Too many people I can't remember.
Robert Payton. John toured with Robert Palmer. John.
And Marcus, he played with Clover.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did. Don't admit to it. Also, we Gravenites and Chipolino and tons of folks. And we're very blessed also to have later tonight Nick Gravenites, the Electric Flag. He was born in Chicago and a thousand other great blues songs. But anyways, enough of me babbling. Let me get you back to the music.
We got Doug.
Yeah, don't forget Cousin Dougie, man.
That's right, I forgot.
Cousin Doug Harman from 1001 Bands by Tony's Fault. Yeah. Zero, Laura Rowan, Mitchell Holman.
Norton Buffalo,
there you go. Band of All-Stars, guys.
There you go.
These guys have rich histories of music. In which they're here tonight for our listening pleasure. So I'm giving the mic back to John here and Al and the boys. So let's give them a big art house welcome.
All right, thank you.
No, that was my voice is too loud.
Hey, look, when we played out here last year, after we did, just for fun, the next day, Doug and Marcus and John and I went to the little studio and recorded a few songs, just kind of the way we did them here, because then I'd never recorded them, plus these guys had never played with us before. They just showed up and just fit right in. So let's start with one of those. Just to warm up.
Ooh, you got to take me as I am, but you don't get me off. Cause I'm from the South, and I'm always gonna say y'all. A man that is what it is, and you know that I ought to do. So take a me as a man, ain't gonna mess with you. No man said, ain't gonna mess with you when the sun is just as fine. So keep me comfortable, most of the time. I love you, but you gotta be free. You want to be in love, but that's changing.
Still remember.
Yeah.
Here we go. You always put me in a love trance. It always starts with a slow dance, teaching me about true romance. My baby puts me in a love trance.
Back in 1980, this guy over here on the drums calls me up. John and Doug are originally from Texas, but we went to L.A. in the early 70s. John and I to join Spirit. Doug came up here with a band he was in called Balcony's Fault. But by 1980, I'd moved back to Texas, and I got a call from this guy back here saying, hey, you want to go to Europe with John Cipollina and Nick Gravenites? We need a bass player. And I said, yeah, sure. So it was the last minute because their bass player fell out. And so...
Literally.
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
I flew to San Francisco. We had one rehearsal. We were on a plane to Finland, and we were off and running. Finland, Sweden, Denmark, Germany, Holland, England, back to Germany for a TV show called Rock Palast. And they were kind enough to, besides me fitting in doing their songs, we ended up doing a couple of my songs. And this is one of those songs that was on the album we did at the end of the tour. And this is one called Trust Me. Trust me.
she said, in a tiny little voice. Trust me, she said, I will breathe from choice. Trust me, she said, I know better than you. What you need to survive, what will make you feel alive. Trust me.
Some of our songs. If you have any requests, feel free.
Mellow Morning.
Mellow Morning. Okay.
Mellow Morning.
NYC.
Boring. Yeah. Are we gonna do that?
Yeah, we do Mellow Morning.
Okay, I need to switch.
How do you want to
save the cracker? Safecracker? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Going into the vault.
Here, Jamie.
I'll go into the vault with you. Okay, yeah, as mentioned before, my brother and I were in the band Spirit and did an album called Feedback, and although most of the stuff was
rock on that, that we did have this song called Mellow Morning. It was in there. Written at the bank in Canada. She said
that's the right terminology too.
Remember the canyon store up there,
and
the post office, and the kid that was in Father Knows Best, it was a nice clean cut kid in the show, was by that time was a hippie and was always hanging around the bar there. What was his name? Billy Gray. Was that
Billy Gray? Yeah.
How about this? In fact, you guys did this with us. Let's we've been to Topanga Canyon. Let's make the jump to Brazil. This is a song written in a hammock in a little town called Pipa in northeastern Brazil. There's a little
To remember, and a couple of these guys have never played with us before, so let's see what happens then.
Whisper conversations in the night, unfamiliar shadows always frighten me. I held my breath and pray for the dawn. I knew that something strong was speaking up for me. The first clue was the kindness. Second clue came straight from the eyes. I heard the tumblers fall. Found the combination that she took it all. Should have been saved the way she stole my heart.
Spirit song. This is one I really loved that Randy California wrote.
I'm gonna switch.
Let's hit switch on that one. Yeah.
Get on your spirit guitar.
Yeah.
Nature's way of telling you something's wrong.
Congratulations.
Well, gosh, about something completely different, like a song written on Highway 71 between Austin and Houston. At the time, I thought I was in love with the girl that was sitting next to me, and I told her so, and she said, "What's wrong with you?" And I said, "Are you saying, what's wrong with you for loving me?" And she said, "Yeah."
Exactly.
I said, "That's a good song title." Turned out she was right. I got out before it's too late. But I got a good song. But what's wrong with you for loving me? When you've seen how crazy I can be. Let's start over. Because I know you were growing. My mind went elsewhere. But what's wrong with you for loving me? When you see how crazy I can be. The only flaw in you that I can see is what's wrong with you for loving me. Where you find there's a wine that comes from France. In your mind it's full of common sense. But will you write it strange about it? Very little thing, the only flaw in you.
Turn it up.
Yeah, I need the mic.
No problem.
Yeah. You need the mic, Harold.
Well,
yeah.
Just if you can turn this up. Can you turn? I mean the guitar.
No problem.
This sound very good.
Yeah, I think this is the third or fourth year we've been to the Art House Gallery, and it's great because all you guys come to listen, and we hope that Okay, we had a request for because she heard us do it last year, a song about our buddy Phil Lee. Is for anybody who ever lived in a trailer. Anybody here ever
just the mention of his name makes you laugh.
It's called Night in the Box.
We love it.
I got a little place out on Highway 10. You got to duck your head when you walk in. Walk 3 steps, lay down flat. Girl, the little box is where it's at. Everybody knows this trailer rock. Don't you want to spend the night in the box? Well, it ain't much but a call at home. It's got a microwave and a telephone. No room to fight or disagree. No room to do nothing but hug and kiss on me. Everybody knows this trailer rock. Don't you want to spend the night in the box? Sat in with us last time we were here.
And that was an experience.
Well, you feel like resonating, little brother?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Sometimes my brother just has to resonate.
That's true. Get all three.
What am I talking about, you?
Don't hesitate to resonate.
Resonator. Courtesy of Jamie Howe.
The Resonator.
get it last time. I wouldn't let it off of that. You did try.
We did on the road with Gravenites and Cipollina.
I think I could get one guitar I could play on.
Yeah, would that be nice? We can close. You know, we have a guitar room.
Well, yeah, where's the guitar room?
We need a nice...
Uh-huh.
That's right. So you're thinking, I know what you're thinking. Song I wrote on the 4th of July in New York City one time called Feel the Heat. And what we do? We'll do hot rods first.
Anyone you want. Doesn't matter.
I can do them all.
Okay, anybody from New York here? Come on, there's always a New Yorker.
Lift there.
Huh?
Lift there.
Okay, even if you're not New York, this is... Actually, this song, I don't know if you remember that group from England called Go West. They had that one hit called... King of Wishful Thinking over here. The lead singer from that, whose name I always forget, that John always has to remind me.
Peter Cox. Is that right?
No. Peter Cox. I thought you said Peter Cox. Yeah, Peter Cox.
Tater Tots.
Tater Tots. Anyway.
I used to love those
Smiths. Yeah.
He recorded it on a solo album a couple of years ago. It's kind of nice.
Smiths?
We're having a culinary discussion. A childhood culinary discussion. Fish sticks and tater tots, is that?
Yes.
Yummy. It's always on Friday night.
You're right.
Sounds like a song.
Yeah.
Fish sticks and tater tots. All about Friday night.
They're playing your cuisine.
Okay, now I'm supposed to get in the mood of this song. Okay.
It's 4th of July in New York City, and I'm really feeling the heat. Cops on horseback in Central Park, on Broadway they're pounding their beats. Black men playing jungle drums out on Amsterdam Street. But I'm a light-skinned fed from out of town, and I can really feel the heat. So let me on your quilted bed, who make me feel the things you say. Turn on your defense and tell me I'm your favorite man. Cause it's 4th of July, New York City, fireworks all around. You never know what's going on in Chinatown. The Upper East Side is all deserted. They have houses at the beach, but they're hanging out in Harlem, and man, you can really feel the heat. So let me on your big old bed.
Every time, every time, every time, every time. The evidence in my eyes.
guitars.
What kind of guitars?
You're so polite, you're quiet.
What kind of guitar?
What's that?
What kind of guitar do you play?
This guitar has a little bit of a story. It's a requinto, is what they call it in Mexico. It came from Paracho. I got it in Paracho in Michoacan. It's that little town. Maybe you've heard about it. I think it was in that Robert Rodriguez did that movie of his, you know, in that town where the whole economy of the town is making guitars. And so I went up there one time and looked all around town, and something about this guitar, I just really liked it. But the interesting thing, well, I bought it from the guy who made it. But my brother one day, a couple of years later in Houston, brought over this classical guitar. Where'd you find it?
Antique store.
Antique store or something. He brought it over, and it was a beautiful classical guitar. And we looked in there, and it was made by the same guy that made this. So now we have the requinto, and we have a classical guitar made by Mr. Diaz, I think his name is. Well, let's see, how are we doing for time? I know they like us to play for a while. Take a little break, give you guys a breather.
I think it's been an hour. We'll take a short intermission.
Well, let's do at least one more. In the way we hide the scars, you're waiting for a prince. The knight in bright armor, well, that's fine. But in the meantime, why not settle for a man? 'Cause you've been too long alone. That ain't good for a woman. Too long alone, it's gonna turn you inside out. School girl, poor little rich girl, your dreams too big for Texas, stardust in your eyes. But there was a boy who loved you. He never could understand why you had to say goodbye. But now you've been too long though. Cause you've been too long alone. You've been too long alone. He's back there somewhere. Let's get our special guest, Nick Gravenites, up here. Take a break. Nick, are you lurking?
Yes,
the chair proceeds.
Here, let's just put it right there.
Right there? Okay. I need to use a mic.
This is going to be the first time Nick and I have played together since, the second tour of Europe, I think, back in 1982 or something.
Oh, I remember it well.
She had blonde hair. She had, what was that? That was Murray Chevalier, right? Used to do that.
Oh, man. Watch your stuff. Let me give you mine.
Great.
Just relax. Sit down.
Relax,
sit down. Sit down. Relax. Take your shoes off. Relax.
By the way, I don't know these guys.
I'll do the mic.
They're from Texas. Bunch of foreigners, you know.
Foreigners.
Yeah.
Foreigners.
I've been to Texas a couple times. Had a great time in Houston.
Let me get out of here.
Met an old railroad man there named Ed McKenzie. He took me in and I played some blues there. I had a great time. Because it was close to Galveston, and that's where all the shrimp live. Here in California, we buy shrimp by the piece. Galveston, you buy it by the pound, easily. Cheap pound, yeah. Boy, it was fun buying shrimp by the pound.
I'd eat a kilo right now.
That's the truth. And here, you know, all the artwork back here, psychedelic. Psychedelic. You know what that means? Everybody was high on LSD. And was it loud, too?
You want LSD?
You know.
You want LSD? On
LSD? Of course.
You want LSD?
Yeah. See that person sitting on that moth poupee up there? That was me.
Yeah, sure.
Oh no, you know, you can't discount LSD in that period of time. That was it.
That was before you came out as a man.
That was it. Robbed us. I took my first LSD in 1963. Whoa. In Big Sur. From a guy, he said he had to buy it from the mafia. Because, you know, you could buy anything from them, you know. Boy. And it was a great experience. And it was a great experience for me until I started having heart palpitations. And I stopped. And I was afraid of dying, you know. And it was acid every day during that period of time. Everyone. And it was a magic time for revolution. And from that period, evolved all these great things like sexual revolution, one, women's rights revolution, two. You know what they are. Everything. All the revolutionary things that happened then and infested culture, and you forget about them. It's like, and it wasn't the rockers and everything that was the revolution, it was the people. And it had nothing to do with rock and roll, it had to do with all the other people who weren't playing music. That evolved into their own lives and their own spirit and their own careers. And it was magic. Those are the people that made the revolution, not these crazy people with guitars.
Yeah, you never played one of those.
No. Those can be wicked instruments. in the wrong hands, you know. So, Al, I must ask you, did you rehearse any of my songs with these guys?
Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Just checking.
How about when we do Buried Alive?
Okay, we do Buried Alive. This is a song I wrote for my good friend, Janis Joplin. And she asked me to write her a song, and I did. And I went down to L.A. to present it to her, and I did. And she liked the song, the band liked the song. I went back home here to Old Mill Valley. And Mill Valley, yes. And I heard that the band, you know, they rehearsed it, she rehearsed it, blah, blah, blah. The band recorded their version of the song. And she was supposed to come in and do the vocal the next day, but she died that night. And so this song went on her last album as an instrumental.
Wow.
Now, in the blues vernacular, I could say, that song, that song, that song, paid my rent for 40 years. I mean the rent, you know, not the grocery money. Wow. So, and throughout my career, I've made my living singing about death. That's the truth. I hate to face it, but there it is. This is a song I wrote for my good friend, Janis Joplin. It's called Buried Alive in the Blues. It goes like this. All caught up in a landslide. Oh, bad luck pressing in from all sides. I got bucked off for my easy ride. I'm buried alive in the blue. It's Sunday morning, everybody's in bed. I'm on the street, talking out of my head. This dumb brick wall ain't heard a word I've said. I'm buried alive in the blue. I'm buried alive, I'm buried alive.
small time. I got bucked off of my easy ride. I've been alive in the blues. Now all you people, you can walk on, but your poor dogs make me laugh, but not make me cry. It ain't no use, cause you know
he shall cause a tower to fall, make of you a pyre of flame. Oh, you men of many waters, rich in treasure, wide in fame, you bow unto your god of gold. Your pride of might shall be your shame. For only God can lead his people back onto the earth again. I rarely sing that song anymore, and anyway, there's a lot I want to forget, you know. That was one of them. It's a good song. It just blew it. I'm usually a verse ahead.
One more to break. Okay.
But I wasn't this time.
So, let's do a slow blues.
Okay.
Key of E.
Okay.
No quick change. No hurry. Boom, 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 boom. Let's hear it. Very good. Take it through.
I heard about London water, little Walter too.
They ain't been down, cause they ain't been down with you.
Rhythm and blues singers, they ain't got a thing on you. Waltz time, but the water's forgetting his tootie cool. Well, I heard you're from Chicago, those men are all so bad.
Well, you ain't been down till you guess what you had, yeah.
Blues singer. Thing on you.
Yeah, you'd have the Hollywood dancing in the waltz time, baby. But the water's getting hit to the cheek.
We'll be singing to the left, getting them to the right.
They'll be stacked up like. Yeah, blues singer. Hey, got a thing on.
on the waters, forgetting all about his hoochie coo.
Oh, yeah.
Nick, grab your 90s. Nick, grab your 90s. The mystery man.
Wow. Can we take a break?
Oh, it's break time. Yeah.
Mike says so.
Quit while we're ahead, bro.
Yeah, well, listen, next time I'll put eyes in the back of my head. And I'll figure that one out. Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for... Ready to play for you with all these Ferners up here on the stage. Except for him, he's an old friend. I've known him forever. Really.
Well, you'll come back after the break and do a couple too. Right?
Yeah, I knew him when he was thin.
I'm twice the man I used to be.
That's right.
You're thrice the man you used to be.
Hey, he knew better. You when you looked like that. So.
Well, that's fun playing the art house circuit. You know? This is called Geezer Rock.
Geezer.
That's fun.
Fuck yeah. Dude, you love know? Your shirt.
Anybody oh. here
thank you.
Under 40?
Thank you so much. Yeah. Appreciate it, man.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow.
Hey, he's a kid. Just a kid.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Oh, yeah. It's our demographic.
So enjoy the intermission. Tonight was an uplifting song. I was crying during the song he was singing about Janis. Because he wrote for Janis, and it's, I've heard the recording, you know, the instrumental is on the record, but the words aren't, because she never sang the words, she was dead. But now, tonight he sang the words to the song that he wrote. That's what's the most amazing thing.
No, I tell you, I make my living about death. From my first song, Born in Chicago, I had to do with death. And a lot of my stories and songs have to do with death. Death.
But the song was called Buried Alive in the Blues. It was called Buried Alive in the Blues. Janis was. Thank you.
Hey, that was great. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Oh, still no bottle of water. Damn you. Damn you, Albert Einstein.
Can we get a bottle of water up here?
Damn you, Albert Einstein. Your space-time continuum. All right, here we are again. All right. Gonna tell you another story.
Sure.
Precedes the last one. It could be a long story. It's 1965. I was in Los Angeles. Seeking psychedelic optics from a guy named Delbert Close. We had a shop in Santa Monica called Quirk Optics. Oh, thank you. You don't mind if I spill this everywhere.
Is his guitar coming through the PA?
I was there with my friend Jeffrey. We were looking for stuff. We were opening a nightclub, a psychedelic nightclub in Chicago in 1965. So, we were in LA looking for Quirk Optics for our club. And when I was there, Paul Butterfield Band was playing at the Whiskey A Go Go. This is 65. This is their breakout year. And me being a part of the insider group, I went to hear them. You know, God, they sounded great. And I got to be talking with Mark Naftalin, the keyboardist, and he said he had a friend that wanted to go to this thing called the acid test in Watts. Because he had never taken acid, and he'd been talking to a psychiatrist for a couple of years about maybe taking it, and he thought he maybe he'd go there and make up his mind or something. And Naphtalin gave me this guy. So I took him to the Watts acid test. Now, I don't know if you people are familiar with an acid test, but this is when, you know, they filled up the trash cans full of Kool-Aid and LSD and paper cups. So I took this guy to the Watts acid test, and there they were, big vats of LSD, paper cups. He walks up to one, he says, "Ah, you crazy. They wouldn't do that." No one would. I mean, yeah, you mean you're telling me that that vat is full of LSD? I said, "Yeah, it is. It's the good stuff. Watch out."
Good stuff.
He says, "Ah, they wouldn't do that. You're crazy. Out here in the open like that." I said, "Yeah, they do that. Yeah. Oh, no, they wouldn't." He takes a cup and he starts dipping into it and drinking them down.
Oh, my God. Oh.
Well, he was my casualty for a day and a half. Couldn't leave him. It was dangerous. You know, like, I have to go to Santa Monica and see my girlfriend's cat or something like that. And I had to ride this guy. But meanwhile, I'm in there trying to hold him down, and the band comes out. See, I knew guys on the bus, the further bus, Keezy bus. I knew a couple guys on there. One, well, a guy named Julius Carpin. And I went, go see Julius, you know. Yeah. Went back there and talked to a few people on the bus, talked to Julius. And then eventually the band came out and started to play. Now, I just got back from the Butterfield Band, which at the time was one of the best playing bands in the world. And out came what later was the Grateful Dead. They came out with their guitars and basses, and they turned everything up to 10. They put their guitars up against the wall and just did feedback for an hour. I call it tuning. You know, they were tuning. Wow, oh my God. Yeah. And this, I just from the Butterfield group, who were like one and the two and the bingo, you know. Oh my God. I was horrified. It was a bad first show, let's put it that way, you know. So I rode this guy, I took him to Santa Monica, I drove him around and this and that, you know. The next night I dropped him off. I had to be there, because that's responsible activity. See, the Grateful Dead, to me, they represented what you call the Merry Pranksters. And the Merry Pranksters were dosers. They would dose people with LSD unbeknownst to them.
Huh? Happened to Al.
You know, and hey, to me, that was fair. A dope crime. You didn't do that to people.
That's right.
A lot of people lost their lives and their sanity that way. It was ugly, and I didn't like it. It was like, I remember those early hippie days in San Francisco. Man, it were like it was tension between the dosers and the non-dosers. People, there were like wars, you know, like, you're an asshole kind of stuff. You know, it was happening, for sure. So I was on the side of no dosing. This guy had to carry him around. Responsible dosing, I guess. Jeez. Oh, they wouldn't do that. Naphtalin, you. Okay, where was I? Oh, 65. Also was the year that Paul Butterfield Blues Band recorded their hit album, which featured my song, Born in Chicago. I wrote that song. And my egotistical way, I feel that it was the beginning of the white blues revolution.
True.
And I put a whole lot of honkies to work. Hold on. Many. But this is my first song of death called Born in Chicago.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Say about that boy, he died bold. My second friend in town when I was 21 years of age. My second friend went down, yeah, when I was 21 years of age. One thing I can say about that boy, he died brave. Someone left to play the game. Rules are all right. There's someone left to play the game. Yeah. But all my friends are going, I tell you, things don't seem the same. No. Seems
65. Oh, what a year. I was in Newport when Dylan went electric. I was hanging with the Butterfield Band. They're the band that Dylan went electric with. Those guys.
That's right.
All of them. Sammy Lay on drums. Oh! Classic. And I was there. I was part of Albert Grossman, who was the manager, his entourage. I drove Dylan from the motel to the gig that night. Didn't say a word. Just, he got there. Later, I talked to Bloomfield about it. And about it being booed and people didn't want him to go electric and that sort of thing. And he said he talked to Dylan after the show and he said, screw him, he says, I'm going to make him eat it. That's his attitude. There was no doubt in his mind where he was going. And he was a man of great integrity, Bob Dylan. Something you don't find in the show business very often. Any kind of business. Albert Grossman was his manager. A big guy, man. He had his hand on everything. He got Dylan to sign a personal services contract on his first meeting with Dylan. He said, Bob, you know that contract you signed with Columbia is invalid because you were under 21 years of age. Now all you have to do is give me permission to go back and renegotiate that contract. In other words, oh boy. That's the truth. He's going to put the knife to him. And Dylan said, listen, I signed that deal at Columbia with John Hammond, who to me is an American icon in music and things that he's done for American music. And he's a friend of mine, and I made a deal with him, and I'm going to keep it. Period. Wow. And Grossman said, okay. You keep the deal that you made. And that's, to me, told me more about Dylan and, you know, searching through his garbage and stuff, you know, trying to find hidden meanings and hidden things in his life. And it's all you need to know. He's a man of integrity, and everything else is like magic or a trick, as he calls it. So.
Oh, yeah.
What can we do?
I don't know. I've
forgotten half of my songs. Or half of them.
Just sing half the words, that's enough.
Let's do an old folk song, all right?
Okay, like what?
It's an old Odetta song from the late 50s that I learned from a record. It's called Take This Hammer. King V. Take this hammer. Chain. Get to the captain.
Five.
None. Take this hammer. Get to the captain.
I just sing it through one time.
Yeah, take this hammer. Get to the captain, tell him I'm gone, oh buddy, tell him I'm gone. Take this hammer, get to the captain. Take this hammer, get to the captain. Take this hammer. Captain, Lord, Lord, tell him I'm gone, yeah, buddy, tell him I'm gone. I don't want your corn-fed molasses.
Hey,
there's
a change there.
Okay.
I don't want your corn-fed molasses.
my pride. Oh, baby, hurts my pride. All right, now twice as fast. Take this heaven, give you the cat. Take this heaven, give you the cat. Take this hammer, give to the captain, Lord, Lord. Tell him I'm gone, oh buddy. Tell him I'm gone. I don't want your comfort and molasses. I don't want your comfort and molasses. I don't want you cornbread and molasses. No, no, it hurts my pride, oh, but it hurts my pride. If he asks you, was I wrong? If he asks you, was I wrong? Was I laughing? If he asked you, was I laughing? If he asked you, was I laughing? Lord, tell him I was crying. Oh, but tell him I was crying.
Figured it out. It only took me forever.
Yeah.
I started at University of Chicago, a most prestigious university. It was a playground for crazy people, and I was one of them. It was just loads of fun. Folklore Society. Biggest organization on campus. 1956. That's where I met Paul Butterfield. Playing harmonica and I was playing guitar. We're doing folk songs. Oh boy. This was 56. God.
Ah!
Flashback.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it was great, believe me. What a great school. Great school. They had a radical chancellor. My name William, no, Robert Hutchins. Robert M. Hutchins. Youngest chancellor in the university system of America. 33, I think it was. And he completely radicalized the University of Chicago from top to bottom. And one of the important things was that in order to enter, when you entered, they gave you a comprehensive examination. And they figured out where in the university they'd place you. If a guy was a genius with math, they'd start him off working on his master's degree. Because that's where he belonged, or her. And they had a no age limit on who could apply. He had children there with IQs of 192, you know, entering children. And he had people in from Korea, the GI Bill. They had these battle-hardened Marines, you know, going to school there. Because back then you could go to any school you wanted on the GI Bill. Harvard, University of Chicago, Berkeley, sure. Sign up. And so, and it was a radical, first, you didn't have to go to class. Now, I love that part. Now, the only exam that came was the one at the end of the year. Comprehensive exam. Took all day, morning and afternoon. Took a lunch break. And they just did the whole course right there, Pat. You know it or not, bingo. That's it. That's the... People would come in from New York, go to the bookstore, get the syllabi, fly back to New York, and come back for the exams. I mean, you know, you didn't have to go to class. I loved that. I was a real gangster then. I really was. And I had a great time there, man. I've met some great people. And that's where I got into the blues, right there. The University of Chicago was the white pimple on the black ass of Chicago on the south side. It was surrounded on three sides by the Blues Ghetto and one side by Lake Michigan. There was no way in or out. And it was isolated in more ways than one. People would, you know, I lived on 35th Street on the west side. This was on 55th Street on the east side. And I didn't even know it existed. Never been there, didn't know what it was, where it was. It was just an island of sanity. Creative. It's all could be.
We have time for one more song. So.
All right, what do we do?
Uno más.
What do we do? Something familiar?
You can do that.
No, feeling full, I don't get to talk.
Okay, let's do something else.
Yeah.
Just groove.
We can do Help Me. Key to G. Like Green Onions. That's it.
Yeah.
All right. We're going to put a nail in the coffin of this, eh? You gotta help me. I can't do it all by myself. Cause if you can't help me, I'm gonna have to find myself somebody else. I may cook, I may sew, I may wash, might even mop the floor. Baby, I can't do it all by myself. And if you can't help me, darling, I'm gonna find myself somebody else. Bring me my nightshirt, put on your morning gown. Bring me my nightshirt, put on your morning gown. I don't feel too much like sleeping, baby. I just feel like lying down. You help me, darling. Now
me now. Help me, yeah. If you can't help me, darling, gonna find myself somebody else. Yeah. Sing the blues. Sonny Boy Williams.
Amazing, overwhelming show that just blew the rock roof off the stage. My God, one of the best shows I've ever been here. I'm still kind of really kind of crying and sad about the song about Janis, but you know, there's a reason for everything, and some reasons are sad reasons. And anyway, she's still here with us with the music. It'll live on forever. All the music will live on forever. That's what's so amazing about the 60s. The music was incredible.
I thought it was all nonsense myself, but no reasons out there.
Yeah, well, you were part of it, so you know.
Stumbling around, you know.
So listen, you're welcome to hang. I want you to hang out, mix and mingle, make some friends, talk to musicians. Right. You can have them autograph the poster and talk to them about the music, and there's so much history for tonight, it's just overwhelming.
You've been very kind.
Thank you.
And you're amazing. Thank you. Hang out and mix and mingle and whatever. You want to say anything else?
I do. It does. Thanks to you guys. Thanks,
Thank
Mike.
You.
I met Mike back with Nick and I played back in
Thank you guys for coming out to play for us. It's always a pleasure to have you here. Nick, good to see you again.
Good to be seen instead of viewed, you know.
Now, July 29th, we have the incredible Annie Sampson in her band. Saturday the 29th of this month, August 29th.